Hey you guys, welcome back to my channel. Today I'm going to be filming my 35 week pregnancy update. Today when I'm filming, I am 35 weeks and one day. At this point, I'm going to be doing weekly updates because a lot changes every week and we only have a couple weeks left. So I want to, one, record all of this information for myself to be able to look back on in the future, but also just keep everyone updated because really it's changing every day at this point. So last week I made my first trip into labor and delivery. I was super nervous about that because I'm at a hospital I've never been at before. I've never given birth in Florida before. And I just really didn't know where to go, what to expect. But it was very similar to what I am used to and it wasn't too crazy. And since then, I have been in, I think, three more times. Friday, Tuesday and Wednesday, and then today is Thursday, because when I go in for my NSTs, which are every Tuesday and Friday, they basically take my blood pressure and just send me right on over to labor and delivery. When I get there, it dramatically drops, and then after a few hours, I go home. And on Wednesday, yesterday, I was just dropping off a 24-hour urine, and they kept me there just to make sure blood pressure wasn't too crazy and everything. So ultimately, every time I go to labor and delivery, I'm not seeing crazy blood pressures. It's not a we need to consider getting the baby out now type of situation. But when I'm in my office, it's a lot higher. I'm also getting a lot higher numbers at home, but I know the at-home cuffs are not super accurate. But in the office, I get really high numbers and then it always comes down very quickly, like within 30 minutes or an hour. I'm pretty low, like 130 over 80, like nothing too crazy. They have been doing spot checks of my urine every time I go into labor and delivery, which to my understanding, I think in labor and delivery, it's a little bit more accurate than when they just do the stick in the OB's office. So they've been doing that and it's consistently been going up a little bit, but for a couple weeks, the protein was there, like traces of protein, but it wasn't at a level that was considered preeclampsia. But I think this last time when I did my 24-hour urine, I turned it in yesterday. I think that was the first time that it was over the threshold. So for a 24-hour urine, the threshold is 300. When I first did it a couple weeks ago, I was 168. And so they didn't tell me what I was, which is frustrating because I feel like I have to beg them for information all the time. But she did say I was mild preeclamptic, so I'm assuming I was kind of just over that 300 threshold officially. And then when you pair that with the high blood pressure readings that they're getting every so often, that definitely considers me a mild preeclampsia case, which honestly I'm not too stressed about because I kind of always see it going this way. And you know, we can handle that. You can manage preeclampsia for a few weeks and it has the potential to not be too crazy, or it could get crazy. But if you're keeping a close eye on things, I don't get too nervous about it. We are doing my blood work every single time I go into labor and delivery, and I've never had anything come back that looks concerning in terms of red blood cell, white blood cell, platelets. Everything they're checking to make sure it's not turning into HELLP syndrome, everything has looked normal and consistent, and we're not concerned about that at this point. But I love that they're doing my blood work this often. I feel like before I've had to really beg, can we do my blood work at least once a week so that we can just keep track of that? Because that can kind of be a behind the scenes thing that's going on that you wouldn't really feel until it gets bad. So you could start to see some trends earlier if you're paying attention to it. And I love that every single time I go in, they're doing my blood work. And I guess that's maybe one of the positive things about this is when I go into labor and delivery, they do an NST on the baby. They check my blood pressure like every 20 minutes. They do a spot check on my urine and they do blood work, which blood work is not fun to do all the time. And a couple of the times they wanted to put an IV in just in case. And getting an IV in is so much worse than just taking blood, in my opinion. Like, they're digging around, they're having trouble finding a good spot, and it's just terrible. But I love that all of that's happening really quickly in one location. I don't have to go run around town and go. Typically, I go to Quest to get blood work done, and I have to make an appointment and wait over there and do it myself. And it's just a whole thing, but it's so nice that I can just go in there and get all of this information really quickly. But it is frustrating. I would say the number one frustrating thing is seeing different blood pressure readings so often. Dramatically, super high numbers in the office, super low. Like, I was getting like 125 over 75 a couple times in labor and delivery on Tuesday. I was like, that doesn't make any sense. Like, I just can't comprehend why it's just so all over the place. And is it really all just my stress and anxiety? But then we have the protein now, so now we know it's not just my stress and anxiety, but it's just crazy. Like, when even when I'm at home getting just drastically different numbers than what I just got at labor and delivery, it's just frustrating. And obviously, if I get really high numbers at home, I'm going to go in or call my office and just kind of give them a heads up and see what they want me to do. I haven't really got any crazy numbers, but it's hard to kind of pay attention to the increases if it's just all over the place. I really don't see any trends. I don't see things slowly going up or down or whatever. Like, it's just all over the place. And I know, I'm sure the doctors are confused too, because they want to keep me to 37 weeks. That's the goal. I'm 35 in one day. I have 2 weeks, hopefully. And they don't want it to get really bad all of a sudden. They want to try to keep it like managed where it is right now. So when I went in to labor and delivery yesterday, I had a different doctor I'd never seen before. And she, you know, wasn't familiar with me, but she was looking at my blood pressure readings that were like maybe 140 over 80, 135 over 85, like somewhere in there pretty consistently. And she was like, well, let's just do blood pressure medication. And I had never had anybody say that previously. And with my other two pregnancies, I had HELLP syndrome and preeclampsia. I had never taken blood pressure medicine while pregnant. I took it for 2 weeks postpartum with Julie. But I've never dealt with this where I'm considering taking blood pressure medicine while I'm pregnant. So the nurse walks in and just hands me a pill and says, take this and you can't leave until we see how this affects you. And then in like an hour or so, you can leave and then you'll just take this medicine the rest of the pregnancy. I was researching it a little bit. I didn't find anything super alarming. It seems like it's a pretty common thing that they do give pregnant women who have high blood pressure or preeclampsia. So I was like, all right. I don't feel like my blood pressure readings consistently are super high. It's only like that first initial reading when I go into the offices. But I figured if it could consistently keep my blood pressure down, it's not gonna have any negative side effects. Might as well just take it for a few days and see how it goes. So I took it in the office. It was like 1 o'clock. Within like 30 minutes, I started feeling terrible. Super bad headache, shaky. And I hadn't eaten a lot that day. I was snacking a little bit, but I hadn't had like a full meal in a while. So I was like, maybe I just need to eat some food. But I felt bad right away when I started taking this medicine. I had to look it up because I'm terrible at remembering names of medications, but it's labetalol is what they put me on. 100 twice a day is what they wanted me to do. So they just gave me 100 that one time in labor and delivery and said, let's see how you look. So I started feeling terrible. And they were taking my blood pressures, and it was like 130 over 80 was kind of consistently where I was. It wasn't really going down, but they were concerned about it going super low. So they didn't want it to go low and have me be, you know, super low blood pressure either. So they're like, well, you're not going low, so you're fine. I was confused because it wasn't going any lower than it was before. But I was like, okay, I'm going to get some food in me and then we'll just see how I feel. So I ate a bunch of food and that did not help at all. I felt the same, if not worse. And as the evening was going on, I was just feeling really shaky and almost like I was having anxiety attacks. And I didn't feel like I was doing anything crazy. I was just feeling terrible, really bad headache, super shaky, and just gross. So I went and picked up the prescription for the medicine, but I didn't take any more that night. She told me to take more, and I was like, can't do that. I can't do it. And I'm still diagnosed with gestational diabetes. I do test my blood sugar every once in a while still, but it's been really low, like under like 105, like always. And I was noticing some higher blood sugars, which they do say is a symptom or, you know, something that happens because of this medication. You can have higher blood sugars and your baby can even have issues with blood sugar when they're born if you're on this medication. So I didn't like that. I was like, I've not seen these high blood sugar numbers. This is weird. I started taking my blood pressure at home a couple times throughout the night because I was like, I feel like I have high blood pressure right now, like because of the anxiety and the shaking, and I was just not feeling good. So I was taking my blood pressure and it was really high, like highest I've seen at home with my blood pressure cuff. So even if it's off a little bit, I knew it was still higher than I was seeing. And so I was like, I mean, maybe my body will get used to it after a couple days, but I only have a couple weeks left and I don't want my mental health and my blood pressure is going to be elevated. My blood sugar is going to be elevated. And honestly, with that bad of a headache, it almost felt like it was like going to turn into a migraine. I was like, I'm going to be just like bedridden, basically like laying in my bed or on the couch, like so miserable. And, you know, maybe it would feel better after a few days, but I just don't really feel comfortable with blood pressure medication. I've never taken it. When I took it with Julie postpartum, I wanted to get off of it right away because I felt like it made me feel kind of gross too then. So I just don't really want to do that. And it was frustrating in the hospital that they didn't really talk to me about it at all. They didn't give me an option. The nurse walks in and hands me a pill and says, take this now and you can't leave until we see how it affects you. And I was like, okay. I didn't have a whole lot of chance to process that, but I don't feel good about that. So I have an appointment tomorrow on Friday, and of course we'll discuss that and see what my options are, but I've never had to do blood pressure medication while I'm pregnant before, and I don't think my numbers warrant that at this point. Now, if in 3 days I'm getting crazy high numbers consistently all day long, and that's the way to keep the baby in, then yes, I will do it, but I don't think I need to at this point. I think honestly the doctor was just like, I don't really know her, and she needs to stay good for 2 weeks. So this is how we can keep her good for 2 weeks. But I've also heard a lot of feedback from other people who've taken that medication that it doesn't even really lower your blood pressure that much. So I don't think that's for me. And that stresses me out because you guys know I hate going into the doctor and having to argue and stand up for myself all the time. But like, I just feel like this was not a good call for me. I think that's basically, you know, the important stuff that's happened in the last week. My swelling's about the same. I've been resting a lot, so I feel like that's not getting out of control. I am going to have blood work done later today for my thyroid. I haven't talked about that in a while, but I've been on the 137 dose of my thyroid medication for months and months. They never increased me and I was doing good. I feel like I'm just feeling a little bit off though. So I wanted to do my blood work for my thyroid a few days early and just see where that's at, because last time I did my TSH, it was really low. It was like 0.5 or something like that. And I think if it gets lower than that, it could start to cause issues with taking too much. I might need to scale down. So I might start doing that, because I was going to scale down anyway postpartum. You can kind of come off of it slowly. But I don't know. I don't think it's normal for my body to need less at the end of pregnancy. Usually you need more. But that's just kind of what I'm feeling. Like my gut feeling is like, I need to look at that and maybe adjust that a little bit. I'm just very uncomfortable with medication in general. I've never been on consistent medication in my life and I don't like the thought of it. I'd like to do things to prevent the need for medication. And so it just makes me really uncomfortable and anxious. And I feel like we're going in a route that's like, okay, well, let's just load you up on all this medication and then you're going to feel terrible. So then we'll add on more medication to make you feel less terrible. And it's just a lot for my body, but also for my baby's body, because I don't know how much of this is affecting them. I honestly don't. And I would rather minimize it if I can. One of the things they always ask me when I go in is, do you have any headaches? And I'm like, yeah, I've had mild headaches like on and off a lot, actually, the last couple weeks. And they're like, do they go away with medication? And I'm like, I don't know. I don't take medication. I never take pain medicine because I have a very sensitive bladder. And a lot of times if I take any type of pain medicine, it irritates my bladder. And so I never take pain medicine for headaches. Definitely not. And so they asked me that and I'm like, I don't know. After a couple hours usually, or even like after I go to sleep and wake up the next morning, I usually feel better. I am walking a fine line between I want to make the best decision to keep the baby in as long as possible, keep me as healthy as possible, but also not doing a bunch of things that are just kind of protocol but aren't really necessary, that make me way more stressed out. Because I feel like the biggest thing at this point for me is stress and anxiety. If I can minimize those things, I will be okay. But I feel like they keep adding on more and more things. The more doctor's visits, the more NSTs that we do, I feel like the more I'm freaking out, because every single time I go in, I know my blood pressure is going to be high. And then I'm like, okay, I'm going to spend hours dealing with this today. I have my kids at school. They're going to have to stay late, or my husband's going to have to get them. And it's just a bunch of added stress, where I honestly feel like if I just stayed home and just said, hey, I'll let you know if I have an issue, I would be okay, because I feel like I know when I'm going to have an issue and I can keep track of it, because I do feel when my blood pressure does get high, I get like really hot in the face. Like, I know what pains to look out for, what concerning symptoms to look out for. But of course, they're not going to just trust everyone to just deal with it on their own and come in if they have a problem. They want me to come in, but that I feel like is adding to the problem. But that's all I have for this week's video. And next week I will try to do a 36-week update. And who knows, that might be my last one. One thing that they told me, actually a couple of things that I was really interesting. I was talking for a while with one of the nurses in labor and delivery. And she said, one, steroid shots. I've always gotten steroid shots with my kids. And I think it's because my issues start to come up around like 33, 34 weeks. She was saying that typically if you're past 34 weeks, they don't do steroid shots, at least in her hospital, that's their thinking. And so I was surprised by that. I've always got steroid shots, and I thought that's what we needed to do this time to help the baby's lung development is what it's for. So I guess we're not going to do that this time, which kind of makes me happy, because they're not fun for me. It's just another thing that we're adding into the mix, that if we don't need to, if they feel like there's no issues and they feel confident about that, then I'm good, because I'd rather not anyway. And then she was talking about NICU time, because my son was born at 36 weeks, no NICU time. My daughter was born at 37 in 2 days, and she did do NICU time because she had some air in her lungs, and that was a kind of a random thing that happened. It wasn't because she was really small or her lungs weren't working correctly or anything like that. So it's just kind of random sometimes if they go to the NICU. But she said they just changed the policy. It used to be if your baby is born before 35 weeks, they have to go to the NICU. Now it's if your baby is born before 36 weeks, they have to go to the NICU. So currently, right now, 35 and 1, I have five more days until I would be in the clear from that. And so that's my next goal that I need to meet, because I know from experience when you get in the NICU, it's hard to get out because the baby needs to be able to do all of these things. And sometimes they can breastfeed, but they're not really given a whole lot of opportunity to, or there's just a lot of like benchmarks I need to meet that they might have been fine otherwise, but it's hard for them to meet all those benchmarks in the way that they need them to in the NICU. So Julie was in there for a lot longer than I felt like she really needed to be, but they were trying to make sure she was like really healthy and could drink a lot at once. And so I would like to avoid NICU time unless there's like, you know, something that really needs to be taken to the NICU for. But that was interesting because I had never been told like there's an official cutoff. I always thought it was like evaluate the baby, and if they need to go, then they need to go. But apparently there's like an official, like even if your baby's perfect, they have to go still, and then have to go through all those hoops of meeting all of these requirements to be able to leave. So that's good to know. Also, something about the steroid shot that they told me is it jacks up your blood sugar a ton for like a whole week if you take the steroid shot, to like 200 or 300 for a whole week. So that could affect your baby and it could affect you. And it was interesting because no one had ever told me that before. So it's like my past pregnancies, I probably had way worse blood sugar than I do this pregnancy because I took the steroid shot. And it's just ironic that I have gestational diabetes on paper this time, but I probably have had great numbers and I'm not doing the steroid shot this time. So I'm not even gonna have that giant spike like right before I have the baby. So I'm learning a lot this pregnancy, which is kind of sad if this is going to be my last one, because I feel like I have so much more information now than I did the last couple times. But it's all been very interesting, and even the gestational diabetes thing has taught me a lot about just like myself and like how I eat and everything. So it's been very interesting, but I would love to have less stressful doctor's appointments and just less in general. That's the big thing, is like I just can't wait to have a baby and just be done with the constant going in and dealing with whatever they're going to throw at me that day. But I'll see you guys in the next one for my 36-week update, hopefully.